Friday the 13th, Part 3, The Novelization by Simon Hawke. Chapter 3. Vera ran down the porch steps, climbed into Rick's white VW bug, and started the engine. It caught with a cough and sputter and settled into a steady chugging idle. She shifted into first and started to pull away, when Shelly came running out of the house waving at her.
Hey! Hey! Hey!
He yelled, waving his arms and running toward the car.
Let me go with you. I gotta get out of here, too.
Geez, that's all I need, she thought, letting out the clutch and accelerating past him, kicking up the dust as she spun around and headed for the bridge. Then she made the mistake of glancing up in the rearview mirror. He looked so forlorn and pathetic standing there gazing after her that she simply couldn't help herself. Against her better judgment, she stopped the car, sighed, and opened the passenger door. Elated, Shelly came running. I just know I'm going to regret this, she thought as he got in, beaming. She shook her head in resignation, cursing herself for being soft-hearted, and drove off across the bridge.
Chris! Chris! Wait up!
Yelled Debbie, running down the trail after her. Chris stopped and waited for her to catch up before resuming her walk down to the lake.
What's wrong?
Oh, it's that creep Shelly, Chris said angrily, picking up a branch and tossing it into the bushes, as if she were throwing it at him. What a sick sense of humor.
Oh, that's just his way of getting attention,
Debbie said.
He doesn't know about what happened.
Chris sighed with exasperation. Oh, I know, Deb, but from the minute we got here, I've been seeing things and hearing things. She shook her head. It's probably just my imagination. I shouldn't have come back here so soon.
Relax. Enjoy the weekend,
said Debbie, trying to reassure her.
Nothing's gonna happen when we're all here together.
She quickly tried to change the subject by asking how Rick was doing. He's okay, I guess, said Chris in a resigned tone, but he just doesn't understand. It was clear from her tone that she didn't really want to get into it. Debbie wished that there was something she could do to make her friend feel better, to make her forget what happened. Debbie and Chris were best friends since childhood, and they had talked about it just as Debbie had talked with Chris when she had found out that she was pregnant and had some very serious decisions to make. But what had happened that summer was the sort of thing about which Debbie couldn't really give Chris any advice, because she didn't really know what happened. Not even Chris knew, not completely. Perhaps this was just as well, Debbie thought. On the other hand, not knowing could be even worse. There was a dark secret buried deep in Chris's mind, and there was no way of telling if she would ever be able to unearth it. Not even analysis had helped. A psychiatrist had tried to hypnotize her and cause her to regress, but she had subconsciously resisted him, refusing to go under. Chris wanted to remember, because not knowing frightened her, Debbie thought. Maybe there were some things that people were better off not knowing. Chris only remembered part of what had happened to her last summer, and that had been frightening enough. The rest was a complete blank, a gap that Chris felt she desperately needed to fill. But Debbie was afraid for her. After all, when the mind blocked out something so completely, there was usually a reason for it. It was self-defense. Debbie bit her lower lip as they walked down by the lake. Chris had become silent, staring off across the water. Debbie knew that Chris was afraid of what would happen if she could never remember that missing part of her life. But Debbie was afraid of what would happen if she did. The cashier at the Crossroads convenience store rang up the total as a local high school girl bagged their purchases, several six-packs of beer, a couple of six-packs of soda, assorted bags of chips, cookies, and a mess of candy bars, cupcakes, and donuts that Shelly had grabbed for himself. Vera guessed that he had used restraint because of her. Otherwise, he probably would have loaded up on two or three times as much junk food. She figured that he probably had some emergency supplies stashed away in that makeup kit of his. It was certainly big enough. She didn't even want to think about what sort of gruesome things could be inside there if that hatchet-in-the-head trick was a typical example. Boy, she thought, Shelly was really strange. "That'll be $18.50," the cashier said. "And we don't accept no food stamps." Vera sneered at the thinly veiled racism. She thought, "You wouldn't say that to an Anglo, would you, bitch?" And then her face fell as she realized that she had left her wallet in her purse, which was still back at the house. "Shelly?" she called. He quickly put the skin mag he was leafing through back into the rack and turned around guiltily, blushing like a little boy caught doing something wrong. "I need some money," Vera said, feeling awkward that she had to ask him. Shelly quickly dug into the back pocket of his jeans, pulled out his Cordura wallet, and tossed it at her. Vera reached out to catch it, but it struck the side of her hand and fell to the floor. As she bent down to pick it up, a black leather high-heeled boot with ankle straps suddenly came down on top of it. She looked up to see a hard-looking young black woman in skin-tight black, studded motorcycle leathers standing over her. She wore a dark purple headband and lots of turquoise and silver jewelry. She backed Vera away with a hard glance, bent down, and picked up Shelly's wallet.
"Excuse me,"
Shelly said, moving towards her with his hands held out.
"But I believe that's my wallet."
Before he could take more than 3 steps, Shelly was grabbed by the arms from either side and yanked up on his tiptoes. He gulped and smiled nervously at the 2 bikers who held him. Both wore leather vests with patches of large black widow spiders on the backs. One of the bikers was black with a shaved head, a gold earring, a heavy chrome steel lockup chain that hung around his neck, and a neat little goatee that made him look satanic. The other one was white, sort of punky-looking, with short, spiky hair, shades, an earring, and a cigarette dangling from the corner of his mouth.
"Make a wish."
"Yeah, make a wish,"
retorted the white biker.
Could I buy you 2 a beer or something?"
Shelly said, badly frightened, but desperately trying not to show it. The woman started going through his wallet.
"I'll take that now," said Vera, reaching out for it.
The black woman smiled and arched her eyebrows as she held up a condom in a foil packet that she had found inside the wallet.
"Is this your rubber?" she said.
Shelly groaned with humiliation. Vera grabbed for the wallet, but the black woman was quick to react, pulling it back out of her reach.
"Didn't your mama teach you manners?" she said. "If you want something, you ask nice."
Vera set her jaw, gritting her teeth.
"Please,"
Shelly said.
"Be cool."
Through clenched teeth, Vera said,
"May we please have the wallet, ma'am?"
"That's good," the black woman said. "That's real nice." She slapped the wallet into Vera's outstretched hand. Vera immediately plucked a bill out of it and tossed it down onto the counter. Then she snatched up their grocery bags and stormed out of the market. The punky biker flicked his cigarette butt at Shelly as they released him to run after her.
"Hey, that was a 20.
Shelly said as he caught up to her outside the parking lot. She hadn't even bothered with the change. Then he quickly added,
"Are they following us?"
Vera glanced back over her shoulder.
"No,"
she snapped furiously.
"Good,"
Shelly said with enormous relief. His heart had been racing back there. Vera shoved the groceries into the back seat of the VW and tossed the keys to Shelly.
"Here, you drive. The way I feel right now, I'd probably get us into an accident."
She got in and slammed the door. Shelly quickly jumped into the driver's seat and inserted the keys into the ignition.
"Next time, I'll know how to handle a situation like that,"
he said with false bravado as he started up the car. Then, realizing how obviously phony it sounded, he lamely added,
"Let's just hope next time isn't too soon."
As the engine caught and chugged hesitantly to life, the bald biker came out of the market. He stopped to open the pop top on a beer can and glanced up at them with a mean look.
"Uh-oh," said Vera.
Shelly swallowed nervously, quickly shifted the VW into gear, and stomped down on the gas pedal, anxious to get the hell out of there. But in his hurry to drive off, he mistakenly shifted into reverse instead of first gear, and the car leaped backward with a lurch. There was the awful sound of crashing metal as the VW backed into the 2 chopped motorcycles, knocking them both over and sending them crashing to the ground.
"Oh, shit!"
Shelly exclaimed with horror as he realized what he had done. Oh shit is right, said Vera. Let's get out of here. The black biker threw his beer can to the ground in a fury and raced toward them, whipping the heavy steel chain off from around his neck. Panic-stricken, Shelly slammed the gear shift lever into first and stepped on the accelerator. The car lurched forward, but the biker stood his ground, positioning himself directly in their path.
Hold on!
Yelled Shelly. The guy's crazy, Shelly thought, as he realized that the biker wasn't going to move. He hit the brakes. The car stopped inches away from the motionless biker. He leaned in close to their windshield, giving them an evil grin. And then he snarled and smashed the chain right through their windshield. Shelly and Vera ducked, throwing their arms up to protect themselves from the flying glass. The biker wound the chain around his fist and came around the side. He hauled off and smashed the driver's side window, shattering the glass. As he pulled his fist back for another blow, this one aimed right at Shelly's face, Shelly quickly let out the clutch and the car pulled quickly away. The biker ran over to his fallen motorcycle and bent down to pick it up, intent on giving chase. Suddenly, Shelly made a screeching U-turn. What are you doing? Vera said, incredulous that he had stopped and turned around when their escape was clear.
He went too far this time,
said Shelly, closing his hands around the wheel with a grim determination. He sat hunched over, an intense expression on his face, his lips pressed tightly together, his forehead creased, his eyebrows knitted, and as the biker started to pick up his cycle, Shelly let out the clutch and floored it. The biker couldn't believe his eyes when he saw the VW bearing down upon him. He barely managed to leap out of the way in time before Shelly ran right over his bike, purposely finishing the job he had accidentally started. The other two bikers came running out of the store in time to see the VW pull another U-turn and slide around in a spray of dust heading toward the road.
I did it! I did it! I did it!
Shelly crowed jubilantly.
Did I do it?
You did it, Vera said with disbelief. You were great.
I was great,
said Shelly, riding on the adrenaline high. It was the first time in his life he had ever stood up to anybody. It felt terrific. He glanced up in his rearview mirror.
You son of a bitch!
The black biker yelled after him, throwing the chain after the departing car.
Come back here, you bastard! You're not getting away with this! I'm gonna get you! You're dead! You mother, you hear me? Dead!
They all came running when Shelly and Vera pulled up with the battered VW. The little car looked as if it had been through a war. The windshield was completely smashed, as well as the window on the driver's side. And there were large dents both in the front and back where Shelly had backed into the motorcycles, then run over them full steam. As Shelly pulled up in front of the porch, Chuck reached them first. He put his hand through where the windshield used to be.
What happened to your windshield, man? He said.
Shelly and Vera got out of the car.
We had a slight misunderstanding with the motorcycle gang,
said Shelly, trying to sound nonchalant, as if misunderstandings with motorcycle gangs were something that happened to him every day.
Yeah, but Shelly made them see the error of their ways, said Vera, putting an arm around him. Didn't you, Shell?
Flustered, yet beaming with pride, Shelly managed to stammer.
It was nothing.
Rick came out and his jaw dropped when he saw what had become of his VW.
My poor car, he said with disbelief. What did you do to it?
Vera handed him the keys as she passed him, carrying the groceries into the house.
Yeah, well, we're really sorry, but it wasn't our fault, she said.
A few minor repairs and it'll be good as new,
said Shelly with a shrug as if it were no big deal. Rick ran up to his car and stood staring at it, shaking his head with amazement. Chris came up behind him.
That's it, said Rick, turning on her furiously. I've had it. I thought it would be good for us to spend some time together, but this is a little more than I bargained for.
He threw open the door and got into the car.
Where are you going? Chris said.
Away from here, Rick said with disgust.
He didn't know what the hell he was wasting his time for. Chris didn't seem as if she even wanted to pick up where they left off, and he had no use whatsoever for her friends, especially after this. He started the car.
"Stay with me," Chris said.
"Why should I?"
"Because I want you to," she said softly.
Rick looked up at her. She had that lost little girl expression stuck on her face that he was always such a sucker for. He shook his head.
"You don't play fair, do you?" he said. He took a deep breath and let it out in a heavy sigh. Then he reached across to the passenger door and opened it.
"Oh, get in." Chris ran around to the other side and jumped into the car. Rick shifted into gear and slowly drove back down the driveway, across the wooden bridge, and out onto the road. As they passed the dried-out stream bed, a large figure dressed in grubby work clothes stepped out of the shelter of the trees. He breathed heavily as he watched the VW disappear around a bend. It was happening again, just like the last time. These people were exactly like the others, the ones who had hurt his mother. A raging fever began to burn within him, a white-hot fire of hate threatened to consume him. And there was only one way to quench those flames.
"Hey, let's go for a swim,"
said Debbie, pulling on Andy's arm. All afternoon, he'd wanted to do nothing except lie around in the sun.
"I don't know,"
he said lazily, as if it would be too much of a bother to walk all the way down to the lake.
"We'd be all alone,"
Debbie said seductively.
"We could do anything we wanted, and nobody would see."
Andy grinned.
"Sounds disgusting,"
he said.
"Let's go."
"I'll grab a couple of towels,"
she said, smiling at him.
"I'll see you down there."
She went over to the van and slid open the side door. It was really strange, but ever since she'd found out that she was pregnant, she'd been really horny. And it kept getting worse and worse. She had expected to feel positively ill. Well, there was the occasional bout with morning sickness, but other than that, she felt terrific. Chris had even commented on it. "You've got a glow," was the way she had put it. She remembered her mother always complaining about it, always bringing it up each time they had an argument, rolling her eyes in agony and saying,
"I carried you for 9 months. You don't have any idea what that's like, Debbie. You shouldn't have to experience something like that and then wind up with an ungrateful daughter."
From listening to her mother, Debbie had expected this to be a terrible experience, but so far, it was wonderful. She couldn't even tell that she was pregnant yet, at least not by looking, though she checked herself in a mirror every day, but she could feel the changes taking place inside of her. She knew the experience would not be terrible at all. It was something wonderful. Andy was taking it in stride. The responsibility didn't seem to frighten him. He knew it would be hard for them, especially at their age, but he had simply accepted it and decided to make the best of it. A lot of guys would have freaked out, but not Andy. He stuck by her just like she knew he would.
"The way I see it,"
he had told her,
"the important thing is that we really want this baby. It's going to be tough for both of us, and money's going to be real tight. But if we stick together, we can make it. We didn't plan on this. But since we've decided we're going to have this baby, we got to make sure we really want it. We can't go blaming the kid if things get tough. The baby didn't make things tough for us. We made things tough. Now we just got to go for it and do the best we can."
If she ever had any doubts about him, they had disappeared then. The important thing, she thought, is that we remember the mistakes our families made with us and not make them with our kid. She knew it would be hard, but she also knew it would be worth it. She was so preoccupied with her thoughts, she didn't hear the soft crunch of gravel beneath the heavy black engineer boots on the other side of the van. She pulled several towels out of her beach bag and zipped it back up, then trotted off toward the lake, just as the punky-looking biker from the roadside convenience store slowly came around the back of the van. Okay, Slashaholics, this has been Chapter 3 of Friday the 13th, Part 3 by Simon Hawke. Want to say thank you to our guest voices from the Patreon page tonight. That's Shawn Campbell playing the part of Andy, Christopher Burns Swanson playing the part of Shelly, Bonanza Jellybean was in there, and she was playing the part of Debbie. We had Roger, the one and only SlasherPepper, Roger Walker. He played the one line of Loco tonight. He'll be back for the next chapter. And we had Tyrone Kinard playing the part of Ali. Thank you all so much for doing an excellent job voicing these characters tonight. And thank you for supporting the channel on Patreon. It means a lot. As far as tonight's chapters go, one of my favorite parts of this movie, even though Part 3 is not even in my top 5 favorite Friday the 13th films, I will say that I enjoy the whole scene at the convenience store and seeing the character of Shelly, you know, deciding he's going to be a badass for a minute, and how Vera kind of starts to see him in a different light. It's too bad that after all that, and even after she was impressed by him, she still couldn't get past his looks. You know, it's like, I thought there was going to be some character development there when I saw the movie, but she just goes right back to being disgusted by him. So, you know, what happens to her on the raft? Good riddance. I thought everybody did a great job. The story is progressing. We got the biker gang now showing up at the camp. And I feel like things are about to get interesting. We all know what's going to go down in that barn very soon. And I'm looking forward to it. I'm curious to see if Simon Hawke gives us some more inner monologues of what's going on in Jason's head like we got in tonight's chapter. That was pretty cool. You know, getting in his head as he was watching everyone, watching Debbie and them and Chris and everybody, and thinking about it's just more people just like the ones that hurt his mother. I would love to get some more, you know, inner thoughts from Jason, as well as maybe some more story on what happened to Chris exactly, what she can remember more than what the movie gave us or the Michael Avalon novelization of Part 3 gave us. Guys, I'm sorry it took me a little longer to get this chapter out. I've been having some health problems lately. It's not great news, but it's nothing that's going to put me out permanently anytime soon. So I will be back very soon with more of this book. I won't make you wait as long this time, I promise. Just some of the stuff I found out had me down and out for a few days and just feeling really bad and tired. Things are going good. Promise I'll be back soon with more. And until then, this has been your friendly neighborhood 80 Slasher Librarian saying thanks for listening, be excellent to each other, and I'll see you soon.